qualified evaluation, not a campaign of political and personal destruction based on lies and deception. What happened to the Kavanaugh family violates every notion of fairness, decency, and due process. Our country, a man or a woman, must always be presumed innocent unless and until proven guilty. And with that, I must state that you, sir, under historic scrutiny, were proven innocent. Thank you.
A remarkable moment. You wouldn't think our leaders would need to publicly defend the presumption of innocence and that it would be controversial when they do, but that's where we are. Politically, of course, this whole thing turned out to be an unexpected debacle from Democrats. The lessons of their defeat are pretty clear. Creepy porn lawyers make bad national spokesmen. Screaming mobs of child activists scare normal people who are watching at home. Wild allegations of gang rape tend to be counterproductive. In other words, it is, in fact, possible to go too far, and they did. That's not a complicated message, and yet none of it seems obvious tonight to Democrats. The activist left has learned an entirely different set of lessons from the Kavanaugh experience. The Supreme Court is a sham. The Constitution is meaningless. The Electoral College must go. Only a country divided into warring tribes can be ruled effectively. If we can't control it, let's burn it down. That is the message they've internalized. Watch how activists gathered at the Supreme Court and reacted after the Kavanaugh vote on Saturday afternoon. Keep in mind as you watch this, this is not a clip from a zombie movie. It's Washington, D.C., 2018. Children of affluence raging, and the rage continued on cable news and on social media. We've got to eliminate the Electoral College, they chirped in unison. White men are bad. Well, the message was obviously coordinated. Important media figures seemed to be saying exactly the same things at exactly the same time, and indeed they were. They were repeating talking points from the Democratic Party, whose interests they faithfully serve. For generations, conservatives called this the liberal media. But that's not quite right. These are not liberals. They're not people who believe in free speech or transparency or due process or challenging corporate power or any other recognizable liberal value. These are party people. They are hacks and joiners and drones. They read the latest pronouncement from the Central Committee like they're scripture. They repeat whatever they are told. They are robots. Liberals used to defend the rights of the minority, and good for them. Watch now as Hillary Clinton explains how entire states should lose their political power because voters don't agree with the majority of rich kids in Brooklyn. Watch this.
Do you think the Electoral College should be abolished?
I said that in 2000, after what happened to the 2000 election with Al Gore, that an anachronism that was designed for another time no longer works. If we've moved toward one person, one vote, I think it needs to be eliminated. I'd like to see us move beyond it. Yes.
It isn't just the Electoral College either. In the past few days, many have been saying the Senate itself should be changed, with different states having a different number of senators. All of a sudden, everybody on the left seems to be saying things like this, including supposedly unbiased reporters. Shut up, Wyoming. Nobody cares what you think. That's the new message from the party that pretends to care about the powerless. But then the left has never been big on self-awareness. Here's one especially amazing example of that. This is an Onion piece waiting to be written. It comes from Tom Steyer. He's a finance billionaire who is one of the Democratic Party's biggest donors. People listen to Tom Steyer only because he sends them money. And yet Steyer's latest crusade is against, and we want to prepare you now for a blast of hot irony, rich, entitled white men. Watch this and savor it.
A group of very rich, very entitled white men wanted to tell the rest of the country, we are going to have our way. And if you don't like it, that is too darn bad.
Yeah, that's what Tom Steyer's against, people like himself who behave like he does. Let us know when you stop snickering, and then think about what Tom Steyer is saying here. He's saying Brett Kavanaugh is not on the Supreme Court because the majority of the U.S. Senate voted for him, as the Constitution prescribes. What's actually happening, says Tom Steyer, is that Kavanaugh was installed by a specific racial group in order to hurt and disempower every other racial group in America. This is tribal warfare posing as democracy, and your tribe is losing. That's what Tom Steyer is telling you. Now, as a factual matter, this is insane. It's the kind of lunacy that would have gotten you booted off a cable channel 5 years ago. It's also a lie, and it's dangerous. It's exactly the kind of thing that Hutu leaders in Rwanda were saying in the early 1990s. Responsible people do not talk like this. And yet, suddenly, it is everywhere on the left, and not just among the professional wackos pounding on the front door of the Supreme Court. The line between dangerous extremist and U.S. senator is blurring all of a sudden on the left. Watch noted race hater Linda Sarsour explain.
I want to introduce to you another champion, another one of our people who works for us on the inside. Please give it up to the senator from the greatest state in the United States of America, my state, New York, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand.
Imagine a Klan leader introducing a Republican senator at a public event this way. One of our people who works for us on the inside. That's the equivalent of what you just saw. Sarsour's embrace of Gillibrand, though, got basically no media coverage. It's normal now. The press just applaud it. How far can this go? Well, spend an hour watching the other channels and see what you think. Here, for example, is a guy with a Harvard Law degree over on MSNBC explaining how Trump voters are actually Nazis. Watch.
Trump has delivered for these people on the things that they care about most. He has delivered racism for these people. He has delivered misogyny for these people. And now he's delivered the Supreme Court for these people. We're going to see if this reign that they now have control over all three branches of government, we're going to see if this reign lasts for 30 days or 2 years or a thousand-year Reich.
All the other people on the panel nod. Ooh, yeah, that's right. A thousand-year Reich. Keep in mind that hundreds of thousands of American men died to stop the thousand-year Reich. And an awful lot of their children and grandchildren grew up in this country to vote for Donald Trump, only to be called Nazis for doing it. Not that Mr. Harvard Law School knows any of that. He probably couldn't tell you the year the Second World War ended. He doesn't care. History means nothing to revolutionaries, and that's why they keep repeating it. Heather McDonald is a Manhattan Institute fellow, author of the book, The Diversity Delusion, How Race and Gender Pandering Corrupt the University and Undermined Our Culture. Peter Kirsenow is a United States Civil Rights Commissioner. They both join us now. Heather, first to you, since it's directly germane to your book title. Into this Kavanaugh debate has been inserted by force by the left questions of race and gender, which are not, certainly race is not inherent to the story at all. It's part of a political tactic. What tactic is it that we're watching?
Well, Tucker, as a close observer of academia, I thought I was inured to incoherence. I thought I was inured to ignorance. I thought I was inured to snarling, narcissistic, blind rage. And yet I am stunned by the direction that this Kavanaugh episode keeps taking. We are seeing the worst of poisonous academic identity politics transformed into the real world with an extra boost from sheer political power grab. This incident had nothing to do with race. It had nothing to do with gender. It was about one thing, due process of the law and the presumption of innocence and whether a case had been made that Judge Kavanaugh was a rapist. That case was most decidedly not made, and yet we see the academic-inspired Democratic left try to turn this into an issue of race. It is simply mind-boggling. It is incoherent. What we're seeing as well at play is an idea that is prevalent on the academic circuit today, the idea of intersectionality, which is the description of the ruthlessly competitive totem pole of victimhood. And we're talking about a white, alleged white victim here, female, but now the whiteness card is being played broadly. Yet she was a white victim. It doesn't make sense, but it turns out the only thing we know, he's a white male. That's all you need to know. He is the worst of the worst. He's the vilest of all creatures.
So, Peter Kirsten, I've been watching carefully for the past 3 weeks, trying to figure out what the message is. And I agree with Heather, it's incoherent, but it is intimidating to a lot of people. The second you start throwing terms like white supremacy around, people cower. What is the right response for reasonable people of all races when faced with an argument like this, which doesn't make sense but has emotional resonance and is scary? What do you say?
Well, I think you have to point out what the facts are. Here it is absurd, it is ridiculous, but it is also the only card that the progressive forces have. By engaging in identity politics, as Heather indicated, it metastasizes up from K through 12 in colleges. Now it's in our political discourse because we really haven't heard any meaningful policy prescriptions from progressives since who knows when, but clearly since 2016. So everything is about race. Everything is about gender because they have to pit one group against the other for their electoral advantage. Consider for a moment that if Democrats don't get at least 90% of the black vote, they go the way of the Whig Party in this country. Despite the fact that they've gotten 90% plus of the black vote, they've lost 3 of the last 5 presidential elections. So regardless of what the facts are, regardless of what the issue is, they must make it about identity because they have no meaningful policy prescriptions.
No, that's exactly right. Maybe the rest of us can point that out. I wish you any more time. Thank you both. I appreciate
it.
Thank you. Thanks, Tucker.
Well, we've laughed a lot at the creepy porn lawyer on this show, and our derision has been well deserved. But suddenly he's a top Democratic presidential contender, and he's also at the very heart of the Kavanaugh story. We'll investigate his links to basically everything that's going on the left right now. It's not hard to see how a creepy porn lawyer can become a presidential candidate when you see his competition in the Democratic Party. To get an idea of what he's up to, there's a new book about it. Check it out.
Michael Avenatti is a beast.
Okay, that's true.
And he's
a beast.
He's a beast, and he keeps popping Donald Trump and all of his folks in the mouth. John Meacham says he may be the savior of the republic.
He really is a master of the media cycle. I owe Michael Avenatti an apology. For the last couple of weeks, I've been saying, enough already, Michael. I've seen you everywhere. What do you have left to say? I was wrong, brother. You have a lot to say. The Democrats could learn something from you.
The savior of the republic. Who gives these people TV shows? For months, as you know, the press could not get enough of the world's creepiest porn lawyer. Hundreds of fawning media appearances propelled him to become a leading Democratic candidate for the presidency, which is where he is right now. But in the last 2 weeks, and entirely by accident, the creepy porn lawyer reminded the public about why evidence and the presumption of innocence still matter in the country and may have saved Brett Kavanaugh in the process. So now his former benefactors are mad and they're turning on him.
Some of your Democratic colleagues have been saying that the Democrats, your fellow Democrats' case against Justice Kavanaugh was weakened by Michael Avenatti.
Michael Avenatti is probably the best thing to happen to Brett Kavanaugh, isn't it? I mean, all these Democrats that have been flirting with him, they've got to really be embarrassed.
A lot of Democrats are saying, and are you hearing this, that Avenatti took what was a sympathetic case with Ford and turned it into a circus, losing them the high ground.
Yes.
The Michael Avenatti circus comes to town.
Avenatti came in with the sweatneck allegations of druggy gang rape stuff that seems to have been much less taken as credible. Avenatti did a huge favor to the Trump White House.
They're concerned that he might be hurting their beloved political party. David Brown is an attorney. He's director of the Brunswick Group. He's a former advisor to Senator Patty Murray, and he joins us. David, thank you a lot for coming on. Does it turn out that Stormy Daniels' former lawyer is not, in the end, the savior of the republic, as MSNBC dubbed him?
Well, I think it gives Michael Avenatti a little too much credit to say that he really was the deciding factor in this. I think we know that now Justice Kavanaugh was confirmed because of a process that the Republicans ran, and they were single-minded and determined in ensuring his nomination, no matter the very serious and credible allegations that were raised against him.
Would you? But they weren't. And I think you're right. I'm not sure that he was decisive in this. They weren't the only single-minded, determined parties, though, I would say, in this debate. The Democrats were those things, too. And would you describe the allegation of his client that she attended 10 consecutive gang rapes, didn't report any of this to police or tell any of her friends or relatives, and that Judge Kavanaugh was present at some of these, drugging the punch? Oh, but wait, she says later, he wasn't. Is that a credible allegation, do you think?
What strikes me about the allegation, and I believe she swore under penalty of perjury, in her declaration. So, you know, I think as a lawyer, that says something to me. But it was striking to me that
Senator Collins contradicted it in a later interview.
Yeah, so my takeaway from that, when Senator Collins said, I think it was October 2nd, Tucker, that she wanted that allegation to be included in the scope of the FBI investigation. To me, that would have been the right way forward, allowing for the FBI to fairly impartially assess the credibility of her allegations by building a fact pattern.
And how would they go about doing that, since she, as you said, already gave her declaration under oath? She named no other person present other than people who already under oath denied that she was telling the truth. There was literally nobody to interview except her, and she was making claims that were so stupid that even Democratic senators were blushing. I mean, there weren't 10 gang rapes in a row in Chevy Chase and no one heard about it. I mean, that's just not true, and everyone knew it. So why wouldn't Democrats say to creepy porn lawyer, come on now, you know, this is not helpful?
I think you did see some members give far greater credence to Dr. Blasey Ford's testimony. I mean, if anything, the focus on Dr. Ford's testimony was very powerful, in part because she did come forward and she did testify, and members had an opportunity to ask her questions.
Right.
But, you know, look, the broader takeaway for me here is that, unfortunately, the FBI investigation was not comprehensive. In fact, Justice Kavanaugh and Dr. Blasey Ford weren't even interviewed as part of that investigation. So I think it was a missed opportunity for us to clear up
I just want to understand what you're saying. Are you saying that because creepy porn lawyer's client, the one who claimed the 10 consecutive public gang rapes that didn't happen, and you know it as well as I, the fact that she wasn't interviewed by the FBI means that he shouldn't have been confirmed? Are you really saying that?
I just want to make sure you're referring to Mr. Avenatti when you're using that term. I don't watch your show. So
I'm not fully familiar. Right. The lawyer who represented Stormy Daniels, who's now a leading presidential candidate for the Democratic Party.
Got it.
Of the Republic, in the words of a best-selling author.
Well, let's get to that, because I'm not sure he's a leading candidate.
Wait, I was curious when I heard you say that. He's visiting. He's been invited by Democrats in Iowa, New Hampshire, and other early primary states. But let me just say, are you saying that because his client, the 10 gang rape in a row client, she wasn't interviewed about her ludicrous claims that somehow Kavanaugh shouldn't have been confirmed? Is that what you're saying?
That's not what I said. I wish that she had been interviewed, and I wish that the FBI could have probed her story and then offered a more complete record. That's what I'm saying. I think that we have a missed opportunity here because there are very serious questions that are still outstanding because the FBI investigation was not allowed to be as complete and holistic as I think many members, certainly Democratic members of the Senate Judiciary Committee, you saw their statement, wish that it had been, and I suspect several Republicans as well.
So if you could just quickly bottom line it for me, just about the creepy porn lawyer, the CPL component of this, would you say you're happy to have him in your party and he should keep doing what he's doing because that's what Democrats stand for, or maybe he should go back to doing whatever it is he does?
I mean, we're a big tent party. I'm happy for anyone who's stepping forward and standing up for what they believe in. But look, it's going to be a really crowded primary field in 2020. So I am not foolish enough to offer any kind of forecast as to who's going to be the nominee in 2020.
Yeah. Well, I'm rooting for him. Well, look, I'm not even a Democrat, but I just want to tell you. I'm four square on his side.
I'm sure he'll be very happy to hear that.
I know you will be. Thank you. Well, John Mayer, who some have described as a big-time womanizer, went on a rant about how men are bad in response to Brett Kavanaugh's confirmation. Was it just political, or is something else going on here? Are people attacking others for the things they might be criticized for? We'll explain it next. Singer and guitarist John Mayer is a very talented musician. He's also got some political feelings, which he's sharing with the rest of us. He's unhappy about Brett Kavanaugh's confirmation. So unhappy, in fact, that he interrupted a concert last night to go on a lengthy rant about something called toxic masculinity.
I don't want it to be the male contract. I'm telling you that's the contract, and we have to tear the contract up. You do not possess the universal ability to have any woman that you see. And I'm just going on record as revealing the trauma of men feeling like they've fallen short of a alpha male contract that nobody can live up to. And until we get rid of that in men, we won't have the life that we all deserve.
I'm going on record, says John Mayer, that I'm against men behaving badly. John Mayer has been accused of behaving badly. Maybe this is a preemptive strike against further accusations. We don't know. But there is more evidence he's short woman than there is for Brett Kavanaugh. But that doesn't mean his rant was surprising. Harvey Weinstein, you'll remember, was a big defender of women, too. Do we sense a theme here? I think we do. Anousheh Hossain is a feminist and a columnist and game enough to join us tonight. Thanks a lot for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
So, look, I don't doubt anyone's sincerity, yours or John Mayer's. I just want to restate, I think John Mayer's a really talented guy. But I remember his song, Your Body is a Wonderland. And in it, he's got this line, one pair of candy lips and your bubblegum tongue. I could go on, but I'm just wondering, is that an example of toxic masculinity right there?
No, it isn't. I mean, it depends on what you think about toxic masculinity. And I actually agree with you, Tucker. I mean, John Mayer, a couple of years ago, I don't think I would have been agreeing with much that he was said. He used to be such a dude, and he said many offensive things. But I think it's a very good example, his recent statements, about how men can evolve and change. And by the way, toxic masculinity isn't about saying your body is a wonderland. It's actually about men being violent towards women. And that song was written for his girlfriend at the time.
Everyone is against men being violent toward women, but I wonder if the standard isn't different. If Brett Kavanaugh's calendar from 1982 had, you know, basketball with squee and then your body is a wonderland and your bubblegum tongue, I mean, you would have called for his arrest, right?
Well, yeah, but John Mayer wasn't up for the Supreme Court, right? I mean, you're talking about two different men.
So he wasn't in the way of Democrats assuming political power. No, it's just a completely different... I'm looking for a universal
standard. It's not the same thing, Tucker. It's not the same thing at all. One man is a singer and the other man was up for the United States Supreme Court. And
the
very serious allegation...
And is in the way of Democrats...
But a very serious allegation came up against Kavanaugh, and that didn't happen with John Mayer. Has anybody ever accused John Mayer of sexual assault and testified?
I hope not, and I'm not even attacking John Mayer at all. I just want to know what the standard is. Is that there's such a thing as toxic masculinity, which is men being male? Is there such a thing as
toxic... No, that is actually completely wrong. That's not correct at all.
There's no definition. It's just like some made-up dumb feminist term.
No, there isn't. There's no real definition. There's actually been studies done on it. It's an academic term, and it's about violence against women.
Now you've further discredited it. Uh-huh. But let me ask you this.
No, I haven't, actually.
Is there such a thing...
Look it up. We're talking about violence against women.
Maybe I'll get right on that.
We're talking about a pop star. Please do.
Look, everybody's against violence against women. Let's be clear about that.
I want to know if there's such a thing in the academic... That's what toxic masculinity is about.
Okay. That's your definition.
Let me ask you, what is the definition
of toxic femininity?
I don't think there is a definition of toxic femininity.
There are a ton of women. Oh, there isn't. So there are a lot of women in prison for shooting. Well, I have no idea. Actually, you know, I'll be honest with you. I don't think that inherent qualities are ever toxic. I don't think there's such a thing as toxic homosexuality or toxic masculinity or toxic femininity. I think the whole idea is insane. People act in a way that's bad.
But you are not understanding what the definition is, and you're completely
confusing
two different points. No, you're not.
Well, then you tell me.
Toxic masculinity is not inherent, and not all men are violent and bad. Breaking news, Tucker. Not all men are violent and bad.
What's so controversial about what
John Mayer said? What's so controversial about that? He's saying don't feel entitled to women. And we are talking, you know, this is coming on the heels of a really intense time. Can I ask you a serious question?
Okay.
Please do.
It is an intense time, but I think all of us as adults have an obligation to think as clearly as we can.
That's why you shouldn't define
it has
toxic
been a
masculinity
commonplace.
Incorrectly.
There's no definition of it, as you know. It's a bunch
there
of ludicrous low IQ
no,
academics.
You're saying that.
Along.
That's not correct.
And you know,
Tucker.
But it is true. But let me ask you very quickly. Why not just say abuse is bad? Toxic masculinity is a quality that is inherent in men. You're attacking an inherent quality.
But
you
not
know
toxic
that perfectly well, which is why you'll not concede that
no,
there's such a thing as toxic femininity.
No, because you don't know what you're talking about. Toxic masculinity is not inherent.
Well.
No, you don't, because you're completely misdefining it. It's incorrect.
Yeah. Okay. I need to read more academic journals, and I will. And it's
Please do.
Great to see you.
Just do
Thank
a
you.
Google search. Thanks, Tucker.
Hilarious. Brett Kavanaugh can barely go outside now. Meanwhile, the Clintons are loud and proud and on tour at a cost. Bill and Hillary are not rich enough, so they'll be traveling across the United States. Will anyone notice? We'll ask him. Great. And as bad as he could be, Bill Clinton at least understood voters and cared what they thought. His party has changed dramatically. They don't care at all. That process, the dramatic change in the Democratic and Republican parties, detailed in some detail in the book on your screen. We'll be right back. Well, Brett Kavanaugh made it onto the Supreme Court. He was sworn in today. and yet the attacks on him, which were without precedent, have made it likely impossible for him or his family to lead a normal public life for some time, maybe ever. No such restrictions, you'll notice, exist for Bill Clinton, though. He and his wife Hillary are going on tour. They are not rich enough. They would like to be much richer, and they think you can help. They'll be visiting 13 cities in the next 7 months to host a series of what they're calling conversations about what else? Themselves. You want to go and pay homage to them? Of course you do. Tickets to the first event in Las Vegas cost a mere $72. That's the cheapest. Mark Stein is an author and columnist. He'll be first in line for the conversation tour. He joins us tonight. You going to this, Mark?
I'm actually rather disturbed, Tucker, that a remarkable number of stops on this tour are Canadian cities. And I don't know whether that's a great insult to my native land. If they feel a bit like one of these superannuated rock groups that are still big in Japan. It's like that kind of thing. And I wonder...
Grand Funk Railroad, yeah.
Yeah, something like that. Still, Grand Funk Railroad is still big in Taiwan and Germany. But it's interesting, after hearing these Democrats talk about toxic masculinity, this is actually the toxin in the form of Bill Clinton going, I mean, I don't know how you get the toxin in the masculinity, for one thing, but I'm pretty sure that however you do it, Bill Clinton's in on the secret. And that would actually be something quite interesting to know about. But he won't be doing anything like that. It'll be bland, insipid Clinton Foundation-type speeches,
yes.
Except that they've run out of Saudi princes and Kazakh warlords willing to pony up the big bucks, so they got to take the act on the road.
It'll be the blandest mush ever served.
Mm.
You spent your childhood being educated in an island nation that gave birth to this country, Britain. And so I want to ask you about this story that emerged today. So the former astronaut American Scott Kelly learned the hard way how dangerous it is to praise anybody born before 1985. Yesterday on Twitter, he posted this quote. One of the greatest leaders of modern times, Sir Winston Churchill, said, "In victory, magnanimity. I guess those days are over." So for the crime of praising Churchill, he was inundated with criticism from users who denounced Churchill as an imperialist, racist, genocidal warmonger, whatever. He bowed to them and responded to, quote, educate myself further on his atrocities and racist views. Whoa, he's been re-educated. What does this tell us, Mark?
Well, I think it tells us the moronization that comes with living in a eternal present tense. Churchill, yes. It should hardly be necessary to say this, was the indispensable man of the 20th century. He presided over the hinge moment of the 20th century, which is the period between the fall of France in the spring of 1940 and the Germans' insane decision to invade the Soviet Union a year later.
Right.
That year, when Britain and its empire stood alone, determined the course of the 20th century. And if it hadn't been Churchill, I hate having to explain this. It's pathetic that one of the few men who's actually got to go up into orbit apparently left his brains out on planet Zongo somewhere. There is no need to apologize for defending Churchill, sir. You live in the world Churchill made. And if some Twitter ignoramus trying to drive you to suicide, because the only point of Twitter is to drive minor celebrities to suicide, if the Twitter mob doesn't know that, get off Twitter. Go back into space. You'll meet a less moronic class of person up on planet Zongo.
You live in the world Churchill created. So as someone who's clearly thought this through, really quick, for the edification of the rest of us, how do we respond when the Twitter mob goes after us for saying something that should be obvious?
I think you actually have to shove it down their throats. These guys are arguing that Churchill was no different from Hitler. No, Churchill was the guy who defeated Hitler when everybody else around him, like the other guy who would have been Prime Minister, Lord Halifax, wanted actually to make peace and accommodate with it. We are living in an eternal present tense, and an eternal
That's right.
present tense means you're eternally a child. You're Taylor Swift. You're Justin Bieber, and that's why you can't comprehend Winston Churchill, because he wears long pants, unlike Justin Bieber.
I knew you'd be the best on that. Mark Stein, great to see you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Tucker.
Everything else in the news has disappeared for the last month. We're waking up to a brand new world, but news has still been happening. The left is pushing an increasingly, in fact, radical agenda. Amnesty for as many as 22 million people here illegally. That is their electoral strategy going forward. You need to know about it. We have the details after the break.
Evaluation. Not a campaign of political and personal destruction based on lies and deception. What happened to the Kavanaugh family violates every notion of fairness, decency, and due process. Our country, a man or a woman, must always be presumed innocent unless and until proven guilty. And with that, I must state that you, sir, under historic scrutiny, were proven innocent. Thank you.
A remarkable moment. You wouldn't think our leaders would need to publicly defend the presumption of innocence and that it would be controversial when they do, but that's where we are. Politically, of course, this whole thing turned out to be an unexpected debacle from Democrats. The lessons of their defeat are pretty clear. Creepy porn lawyers make bad national spokesmen. Screaming mobs of child activists scare normal people who are watching at home. Wild allegations of gang rape tend to be counterproductive. In other words, it is, in fact, possible to go too far, and they did. That's not a complicated message, and yet none of it seems obvious tonight to Democrats. The activist left has learned an entirely different set of lessons from the Kavanaugh experience. The Supreme Court is a sham. The Constitution is meaningless. The Electoral College must go. Only a country divided into warring tribes can be ruled effectively. If we can't control it, let's burn it down. That is the message they've internalized. Watch how activists gathered at the Supreme Court and reacted after the Kavanaugh vote on Saturday afternoon. Keep in mind as you watch this, this is not a clip from a zombie movie. It's Washington, D.C., 2018. Children of affluence raging, and the rage continued on cable news and on social media. We've got to eliminate the Electoral College, they chirped in unison. White men are bad. Well, the message was obviously coordinated. Important media figures seemed to be saying exactly the same things at exactly the same time, and indeed they were. They were repeating talking points from the Democratic Party, whose interests they faithfully serve. For generations, conservatives called this the liberal media. But that's not quite right. These are not liberals. They're not people who believe in free speech or transparency or due process or challenging corporate power or any other recognizable liberal value. These are party people. They are hacks and joiners and drones. They read the latest pronouncement from the Central Committee like they're scripture. They repeat whatever they are told. They are robots. Liberals used to defend the rights of the minority, and good for them. Watch now as Hillary Clinton explains how entire states should lose their political power because voters don't agree with the majority of rich kids in Brooklyn. Watch this.
Do you think the Electoral College should be abolished?
I said that in 2000, after what happened to the 2000 election with Al Gore, that an anachronism that was designed for another time no longer works. If we've moved toward one person, one vote, I think it needs to be eliminated. I'd like to see us move beyond it. Yes.
It isn't just the Electoral College either. In the past few days, many have been saying the Senate itself should be changed, with different states having a different number of senators. All of a sudden, everybody on the left seems to be saying things like this, including supposedly unbiased reporters. Shut up, Wyoming. Nobody cares what you think. That's the new message from the party that pretends to care about the powerless. But then the left has ever been big on self-awareness. Here's one especially amazing example of that. This is an Onion piece waiting to be written. It comes from Tom Steyer. He's a finance billionaire who is one of the Democratic Party's biggest donors. People listen to Tom Steyer only because he sends them money. And yet Steyer's latest crusade is against, and we want to prepare you now for a blast of hot irony, rich, entitled white men. Watch this and savor it.
A group of very rich, very entitled white men wanted to tell the rest of the country, we are going to have our way. And if you don't like it, that is too darn bad.
Yeah, that's what Tom Steyer's against. People like himself who behave like he does. Let us know when you stop snickering. And then think about what Tom Steyer is saying here. He's saying Brett Kavanaugh is not on the Supreme Court because the majority of the U.S. Senate voted for him, as the Constitution prescribes. What's actually happening, says Tom Steyer, is that Kavanaugh was installed by a specific racial group in order to hurt and disempower every other racial group in America. This is tribal warfare posing as democracy, and your tribe is losing. That's what Tom Steyer is telling you. Now, as a factual matter, this is insane. It's the kind of lunacy that would have gotten you booted off a cable channel 5 years ago. It's also a lie, and it's dangerous. It's exactly the kind of thing that Hutu leaders in Rwanda were saying in the early 1990s. Responsible people do not talk like this. And yet, suddenly, it is everywhere on the left, and not just among the professional wackos pounding on the front door of the Supreme Court. The line between dangerous extremist and U.S. senator is blurring all of a sudden on the left. Watch noted race hater Linda Sarsour explain.
I want to introduce to you another champion, another one of our people who works for us on the inside. Please give it up to the senator from the greatest state in the United States of America, my state, New York, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand.
Imagine a Klan leader introducing a Republican senator at a public event this way. One of our people who works for us on the inside. That's the equivalent of what you just saw. Sarsour's embrace of Gillibrand, though, got basically no media coverage. It's normal now. The press just applaud it. How far can this go? Well, spend an hour watching the other channels and see what you think. Here, for example, is a guy with a Harvard Law degree over on MSNBC explaining how Trump voters are actually Nazis. Watch.
Trump has delivered for these people on the things that they care about most. He has delivered racism for these people. He has delivered misogyny for these people. And now he's delivered the Supreme Court for these people. We're going to see if this reign that they now have control over all three branches of government, we're going to see if this reign lasts for 30 days or 2 years or a thousand-year Reich.
All the other people on the panel nod. Ooh, yeah, that's right. A thousand-year Reich. Keep in mind that hundreds of thousands of American men died to stop the thousand-year Reich. And an awful lot of their children and grandchildren grew up in this country to vote for Donald Trump, only to be called Nazis for doing it. Not that Mr. Harvard Law School knows any of that. He probably couldn't tell you the year the Second World War ended. He doesn't care. History means nothing to revolutionaries, and that's why they keep repeating it. Heather McDonald is a Manhattan Institute fellow, author of the book, The Diversity Delusion, How Race and Gender Pandering Corrupt the University and Undermined Our Culture. Peter Kirsenow is the United States Civil Rights Commissioner. They both join us now. Heather, first to you, since it's directly germane to your book title. Into this Kavanaugh debate has been inserted by force by the left questions of race and gender, which are not, certainly race is not inherent to the story at all. It's part of a political tactic. What tactic is it that we're watching?
Well, Tucker, as a close observer of academia, I thought I was inured to incoherence. I thought I was inured to ignorance. I thought I was inured to snarling, narcissistic, blind rage. And yet I am stunned by the direction that this Kavanaugh episode keeps taking. We are seeing the worst of poisonous academic identity politics transformed into the real world with an extra boost from sheer political power grab. This incident had nothing to do with race. It had nothing to do with gender. It was about one thing, due process of the law and the presumption of innocence and whether a case had been made that Judge Kavanaugh was a rapist. That case was most decidedly not made, and yet we see the academic-inspired Democratic left try to turn this into an issue of race. It is simply mind-boggling. It is incoherent. What we're seeing as well at play is an idea that is prevalent on the academic circuit today, the idea of intersectionality, which is the description of the ruthlessly competitive totem pole of victimhood. And we're talking about a white, alleged white victim here, female, but now the whiteness card is being played broadly yet she was a white victim. It doesn't make sense, but it turns out
the
only thing we know, he's a white male. That's all you need to know. He is the worst of the worst. He's the vilest of all creatures.
So, Peter Kirsten, I've been watching carefully for the past 3 weeks, trying to figure out what the message is, and I agree with Heather, it's incoherent, but it is intimidating to a lot of people. The second you start throwing terms like white supremacy around, people cower. What is the right response for reasonable people of all races when faced with an argument like this, which doesn't make sense but has emotional resonance and is scary? What do you say?
Well, I think you have to point out what the facts are. Here it is absurd, it is ridiculous, but it is also the only card that the progressive forces have by engaging in identity politics, as Heather indicated.